From the day you saved my soul till the very moment when I come home, I'll sing, I'll dance, till my heart will overflow. From the day you saved my soul. Every moment when I come home, I'll sing, I'll dance, my heart will overflow. From the day you saved my soul, from the day you saved my soul, till the very moment when I come home, I'll sing, I'll dance, my heart will overflow. From the day you saved my soul. My soul.
All right, you can be seated.
Well, good morning, everybody. Welcome to McQueenie Baptist Church. Good to see y'all here this morning on this nice rainy day, right? We're not complaining, though, are we? No. In fact, I heard somebody, I think it was Kay, just right before the service, she's walking, it's raining again. I said, that's something we rarely say around here, so okay. Just a couple of announcements I want to share with you this morning. Probably the first one you probably kind of already picked up on already. But according to, you know, CDC guidelines and so forth, we are no longer asking people to wear a mask unless you haven't been vaccinated. And we're not checking cards and all that, so it's up to you to make that decision. But we feel like at this point, and probably everybody that really wants to be vaccinated has had an opportunity or can do so. And so we are just going to continue without the mask. Unless you haven't been vaccinated, you probably need to wear one. Okay. The other announcements I want to mention this morning. Last Sunday, we began a special offering for India Village Ministries. It's a ministry that we support in India, and we shared a video last Sunday of what's happening there. Over 400,000 new cases a day, a lot of people dying, having to, you know, just cremate bodies on the streets almost. And so it's a terrible situation, and the ministry there is trying to deal with it, trying to help all they can. And so we are collecting money to send to them, and we had a really good offering, over $7,000 last week that we're going to be able to send to them. And so we're going to continue to collect this offering through next Sunday. And so if you want to get to that, the instructions for how to do it are in the bulletin. So just look at the bulletin, you'll find instructions or a couple of ways that you can give. So just look there and it'll tell you how to go about doing that. Also, tonight we will also have our Genesis history study, a video study that happens tonight in the auditorium. That will be at 6 o'clock. That's going to be preceded at 5 o'clock by our business meeting. Okay, so normally we would have it at 6, but it's going to be at 5 o'clock. So everybody say this with me. It will be at 5 o'clock. Ready? It will be at 5 o'clock. Now you said it, you remember it? Okay. Going 5 o'clock for our business meeting and then the Genesis history study at 6. Also, next Sunday, we have a great treat. Every fifth Sunday, we haven't done this since COVID started. So this will be the first time we have our fifth Sunday sing again next weekend. And so basically it's just people that whoever wants to sing or wants to play an instrument or wants to get up and do your thing, you're welcome to do that on Fifth Sunday Sing. That's right, Maggie, you can dance. We'll let you dance. And so just talk. If you're interested, just talk to Joe, and he puts the program together, and we'll be doing that next Sunday evening at 6 o'clock. We will not have the Genesis study next Sunday because of the Fifth Sunday. And then finally, last but not least, we have our Awana Awards ceremony this coming Wednesday. That means that we will not have adult Bible study and prayer meeting, because at Awana Awards, that's a very special time. We want everybody to be in here to really encourage and support our children that are have accomplished things and are being recognized. And not only that, but this has been a really tough year. And some of the kids have just really continued to work on their steps and their WANA program. And so we want to be here next Wednesday, this coming Wednesday, to support them at 6:30 right here in the auditorium. So please keep that in your prayers. I almost forgot to mention this. With the India Village Ministries offering, our children are being given these little containers, and they're just the right size to hold quarters. And so we want to help our children be involved in helping them learn about benevolence and about giving. And so this is a way that they can be involved in the offering for India. And so they'll get these in their Sunday school classes or children's church or whatever, and they'll take them home, put quarters in them, bring them back, and they'll be able to be a part of what we're doing, okay? I believe that's everything. So we're going to do two more things, and then we're going to begin worshiping again together. The first thing we're going to do is ask you to stand up, and then I want you to just look around. Go ahead, stand up. Everybody, come on, get to your feet. I know you're tired. I know some of you had parties to go to this weekend. But I want you to look around and just wave at somebody. If they're close enough and you want to shake hands, do. But just wave at somebody and say, howdy, good to see you this morning. All right. Last thing we're going to do is have a word of prayer together, and then we're going to worship. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come into your presence today. We're so thankful for the opportunity to be able to be here in person and to be able to celebrate with one another. Lord, the most important thing we can ask right now is, regardless of what's going on in our lives and the confusion and the distractions, Lord, that you would help us right now to be able to lay that all aside, that we could focus our entire attention on you this morning, that our worship would come not just from our lips, but truly from our hearts. We can worship you this morning in spirit and in truth. So, Lord, we give you this time right now because we love you and we want to honor you. In Jesus' name, amen.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemy. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. And I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar up from the ashes. Hope will arise. Death is defeated. The King is alive. I raise a hallelujah with everything inside of me. I raise a hallelujah. See?
sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
Oh, sing a little louder.
Sing a little louder.
In the presence of my enemies.
Sing a little louder.
Louder than the unbelief.
Sing a little louder.
My weapon is a melody.
Sing a little louder. In the middle of the storm, louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm.
I just want to pause and just read a passage of scripture. I just love God's word. You know, sometimes you open God's word and you're looking for something new, maybe that you've never read before, something fresh and exciting. And sometimes you open God's word and you're just looking for that anchor of hope, that familiarity, something that you've read 100 times that just brings you that peace. And for me, it's this verse, and I just want to share it with you. This is from Psalm 63. It says, "Oh God, you are my God, and earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you with my whole being. In a dry and parched land where there is no water, I have seen you in the sanctuary, and I've beheld your power and your glory, because your love is better than life. My lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live, and in your name, I lift my hands." I will be satisfied as with the richest foods. With singing my lips, my mouth will praise you. On my bed, I remember you. I think of you through the watches of the night. Because you are my help, I sing in the shadow of your wings. I cling to you, and your right hand upholds me. Oh God, my God, Lord, I pray this morning that in this place we will be so near to you that we will be in the shadow of your wings. Lord, and we know that there are so many ways that our lives can give praise to you, but this morning, in this moment, I pray that we will be so full of love and thanksgiving for you, God, that our lips will glorify you, and that in your name alone we will lift our hands to you, God. Lord, I know and I proclaim that through it all, God, you are God, and you are sovereign, and you are on your throne. And we lift you high this morning, God. We praise you.
All my words fall short
I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? I could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. I've got one response, oh, I've got just one move, with my arms stretched wide, oh, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. So come on, my soul, oh, don't you get shy of me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lot. So come on, my soul, oh, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Oh, come on, my soul, oh, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside. So that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah.
Lord, we pray this morning that you've been glorified. Lord, we pray that our worship has been pleasing to you. And God, we pray right now that your presence would just continue to be in this place and you would continue to speak to your people. Lord, we know that you're already at work, God. We pray for our pastor, Lord, anoint him with your spirit as he comes. Lord, just, Lord, you give him the words to say to us this morning. Lord, and I pray that you would open our hearts. Lord, so many times we build up these walls and we can't hear you, God. Pray that you would just tear those down right now so that we can hear what it is that you have for us this morning. And Lord, we are excited to hear a word from you, God. We love you and we praise you. We ask all of these things in your name. Amen.
I'm sorry, Brandon. Sometimes I turn it off when I'm supposed to be turning it on, and I turn it on when I'm supposed to be turning it off. So I'm dyslexic that way, okay? Okay, we're beginning a brand new series today in the book of Philippians, one of my favorite books in the Bible. I know it's hard to say this is my favorite book in the Bible. I mean, what do you do with the Gospel of John and 1 John and Matthew? I know, but right, I'm just telling you, the book of Philippians is, I think, one of the most unique books in the Bible. And so we're going to spend some time, four Sundays, we're going to spend the book of Philippians. Not going to go verse by verse through the whole book or anything like that, but I want to hit some of the high spots in the book of Philippians, especially as it relates to the idea of perspective. You know, how we see things, how we view things in our life. And Paul wrote the book of Philippians. Of course, it wasn't really a book when he wrote it. It was a letter. And Paul wrote the letter to the Philippians in about 62 AD. Paul had established the church in Philippi on his second missionary journey. And so when he went around beginning, starting churches, it was his second journey. He established the church in Philippi. You can find the story of that in Acts chapter 28. If you want to kind of read how that got started, you read about, you know, the Philippian jailer and some of those other stories there. And so Paul established the church in Philippi. And so he did that in 52. And then in about 62, he was writing this letter of encouragement and of thanksgiving to the church in Philippi. Now, Paul, it becomes really clear when you start reading this book. Paul really loved the Philippian people. He really loved the church. I know he loved all of his churches, but I think there was a really special connection with the people in Philippi. They were people that supported him. They loved him back. And we find in the scriptures that that he's writing this letter to them as a thanksgiving, kind of a letter of gratitude, because the Philippians had collected an offering to send to him. And it was a time in Paul's life when he really needed some support. Now, we read in the scriptures that Paul often didn't take money from the people that he was ministering to, because he didn't want anything to stand in the way of the gospel, and he often worked as a tent maker to support himself. But in this case, it was a much needed offering, and he received that. And so he's writing this letter of thank you back to them. And one of the themes that really, probably the major theme that rises up in the book of Philippians is the idea, the concept of joy. In fact, the book of Philippians has been called the book of joy, the letter of joy. And Paul is writing this letter, this idea surfaces. You'll see the word joy or rejoice mentioned at least 19 times in the book of Philippians. And so Paul is writing this letter of joy to the Philippian people. And so we're going to be talking about perspective, and the idea of perspective in this book comes not from the fact that there is joy, that Paul is writing with joy. We would expect a believer like Paul to have joy. The perspective comes from the circumstance in which he's writing it. Let me ask you something. Is there anything in your life right now that you wish was not happening? Is there anything happening in your life right now that you just wish was not happening, that this isn't the way it was, that you could snap your fingers and it would be over, it would be gone, and you could have that kind of change? Well, perspective says, when we have perspective, it gives us a way of looking at those things that might just help us do that. It doesn't help us make it go away, but it can help the situation. You know, when I was a young minister, I thought I was poor. Don and I were just starting out in ministry. I was pastor of a mission church, a new church plant. So we only started with six people, okay? So there's not like a lot of money in that, right? And so we had six people. Then we worked all year, and we grew the church to about 25 people, another year about 40 people. So you get where I'm coming from. And I thought we were poor because we were living on very little. And so I thought I was poor, and then I went on a mission trip to Venezuela. And when I got to Venezuela, suddenly I realized that I really wasn't poor. I saw that these people were, most of them families, whole families, living in one-room houses, you know, with one light bulb hanging from the ceiling. And I suddenly realized that, you know, my perspective changed, not because my situation changed, but because I saw things differently. And so that's what I want us to talk about as we look at the letter of Paul to the book and to the Philippians. And so I'm going to give you a piece of information now that may change your perspective, help you understand why Paul, writing out of such joy and gladness, is a matter of perspective. And most of you, some of you, may already know this piece of information, but some of you may not. And here's the piece of information. Paul wrote this letter of profound joy while he was in prison. He wasn't like on a vacation to the Bahamas, okay? He was in a Roman prison. In fact, he was chained to a Roman soldier. He was under what they call house arrest, which means he wasn't actually in a prison dungeon or prison cell. He was allowed to live in his own home, his own place, but he had to have a Roman guard watching him every single 24 hours a day. 7 days a week, he had a Roman soldier chained to him. They rotated in six-hour shifts. Okay? And so this was house arrest. Now, it's not like today. Today, you know, they just put that little thing on your leg, right? I don't really know about that person. I'm just saying I have heard that. I've watched TV, and that's how they do it today, so you can't leave your house. But in those days, they had to actually put a soldier on you to keep you from being able to escape. And this is the situation for the Apostle Paul when he's writing the book of Philippians. So how is it that Paul could be under house arrest for 2 years at least, not knowing what his fate would be? He didn't know how all of this was going to end, whether he would be set free, whether he would be acquitted, whether he would be condemned and put to death. So in this situation, Paul writes this letter of profound joy while he's in a prison cell. How does that happen? How does Paul have that kind of perspective? That's what we want to talk about this morning. So let's start reading in Philippians chapter 1, verse 2, okay? Philippians chapter 1, verse 2. Paul says this to the Philippians: "Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God every time I remember you." Do you kind of feel the emotion in that? You know, he says grace, peace from God our Father. He said, every time I think about you, my heart rejoices. I pray for you. So there's this great love that Paul feels for the Philippian people. And then he goes on in verse 4. "In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with," there it is, see it? "I always pray with" what? "With joy." He said, "I pray with joy, even though I'm chained to a Roman soldier, even though I'm in prison." He said, "When I remember you, I pray with joy." Wouldn't you love for somebody to think that highly of you, to love you that much, that even if they were in prison, you know, you'd expect to be praying for him? But he says, "No, I'm in prison praying for you." And he says, "I pray for you with great joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus." Paul says, "I'm praying for you that God," he said, "I know God is already doing a work in you." I would say that to you this morning as well. Okay? God has already begun a work in you. And Paul says, "Listen, I want to encourage you that he is going to continue that work until it's absolutely complete. You can count on it." And then he goes on. He said, "It is right for me to feel this way for you, since I have you in my heart. For whether I am in chains or defending and confirming the gospel, all of you share in God's grace with me." He said, "Listen, it doesn't matter if I'm in chains or if I'm set free." He said, "Either way, we share in this great grace that God has poured out for us." That's a pretty good perspective. Wouldn't you agree? It's a pretty good perspective. So is there something you wish were different? You know, when I was young, I wished I was older. Now, I wish I was younger. We're never happy, are we? Can't ever be pleased. Can't ever be content. But it's that way in life. We have things that we're walking through. See, I'm rest assured that everybody in here has something in your life that you wish you could just change right now, that you wish would be different. Hunting for a job, can't find one. Your marriage, maybe difficulties. The kids, you know, wish things were different. Wish you had different kids. I don't know, whatever. Not really, I'm just joking. I want to give you three statements this morning that I hope will encourage you, okay? The first statement, and if you're taking notes, these are in your outline. The first statement is this: we all have a what. I already said that. I know for a fact everybody's got something. Everybody's got a what in their life that they would like to change. We all have a what and don't understand the why. There's always something in our life that's happening, a circumstance, a situation that we it's happening, we're going through it, but we don't know why it's happening or we're going through it. The second statement is this: God always has a why behind a what. God always has a why behind the what. Now, don't hear me say, I'm not saying that God is the one who causes every what in your life. Okay, I have it on good authority that many of you cause your own whats, okay? You cause your own problems. I know because I've done that too. What I'm saying, though, is that I'm not saying that God causes everything bad that's happening in your life, the difficulty that you're walking through. I'm not saying that. What I am saying is what Romans 8:28 says, that all things, regardless of what they are, work together for good to them that love God and are called according to his purpose. That regardless of what the what is, God will have a why behind it if we will let him. If we will look to him, he will have a why behind whatever is happening in our life. And then the third thing is this: I don't have to understand the why to trust God in the what. That's the tough part. Because by nature, aren't we? By nature, when something's happening, we want to know, why is this happening? And don't get me wrong, it's not always wrong to ask why. In fact, don't hear me say that it's wrong to ever ask God why. You know, when something's happened, it's human nature. God, why is this happening? Now, the reason I say it sometimes it's good to ask why is because sometimes when we ask why, God will show us that the reason something has happened is because there's something we need to change. We need to act differently. We need to make different choices in our lives. So it's good that we ask why on some things. But then there's always this situation where we see it, we're going through something and we just can't seem to make anything out of it. We just can't seem to figure out why this is happening. Now, what I want to talk about this morning is I want to talk about moving beyond the why. I'm not saying it's wrong to ask why, but I'm saying that it doesn't always produce good results in our life. What's more important is we go on to two questions that I want to share with you this morning. Two questions that you need to ask, you can ask when you're going through a hard time. Two questions you can ask when you're in something and you just can't figure out why it's happening and what you're going to do. Here it is. First question is this: now what? Instead of saying why, I would suggest ask now what. Now what am I going to do? This is what is happening. This is already happening. I can't change the fact that it's happening. But now what? Look at verse 12. It says, "Now I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel." The what has served. Isn't that interesting? The what has served to do something. Sometimes it's hard to understand when the what in our lives is so bad. I mean, take Paul's situation, okay? Let's understand it. Paul had always dreamed of going to Rome to preach the gospel. You know, he'd been on these missionary journeys, but he'd never made it to Rome. He always envisioned going to Rome, the center of the capital of the world, to preach the gospel. But he never imagined that he would be going as a prisoner. He thought he would be going as an evangelist, not a prisoner. And so Paul has gone through this whole journey of being shipped from Israel to take a ship and go to Rome, and you know, all the things that happened to him on that journey, even the shipwreck and all the things that happened. I mean, all these things are terrible things. But listen to what he says. "I want you to know, brothers, that what has happened," he's talking about all of this has happened to me, has really served to advance the gospel. I talked about this passage not too long ago about what it means to advance. That's a military word that was used in military terms. It would be like the Corps of Engineers today. You know, the Corps of Engineers are the guys that go out in front of the army. They're the ones that build the bridges so the men can go over, so the tanks can cross. The Corps of Engineers are the ones that clears the path and fills in the holes in the road so the army can advance. And they have to remove all the obstacles from in the way. And as they remove the obstacles from in the way, then the army can advance. And that's what Paul says is happening here, that what has happened, me being arrested, me being in a shipwreck, me coming to Rome, me being chained to a Roman soldier under house arrest, all of this has happened to advance the gospel, the word of God, of Jesus Christ. Could it possibly be that whatever it is that's happening in your life this morning, could it possibly be that in God's hands, this what in God's hands could actually, even though it may have been meant for bad, even though the enemy may be the one that brought that attack against you, even though it's a terrible circumstance you're going through, but the circumstances already have, could it be that God then could take that circumstance and out of that circumstance, he could use that to advance his purpose in your life? Perhaps. You know, how many of you have ever seen pictures where you look at it and you see one thing and then other people see something else? You ever seen those before? Let's put that picture up. Okay, I want you to look at that. And how many of you, when you look at that, how many of you see a young lady? Raise your hand. Okay, hands down. How many of you, when you look at that, see an old lady? Raise your hand. Okay, fewer people see the old lady. Did you know they're both there? How many of you that saw the young lady can now see the old lady that I've told you that she's there? Okay, all right. You say, okay, Pastor, you know, this is really going off track. No, it's not. I've got a point. Okay? Because when I first saw this picture, I immediately saw the young lady looking over her shoulder, you know, to the right, over her shoulder. I saw it, and then somebody said, well, I see an old lady. I went, nuh-uh. I mean, I couldn't see it. They kept, even after somebody said, look for the old lady. I don't see any old lady. This was driving me crazy, okay? Finally, the person that showed me the picture sat down with me with the picture and said, look, here's her nose and here's her mouth and here's her hair. I went, oh, it is an old lady. Now when I look at that picture, it's weird. I see both of them. I can see both of them at the same time. You know, sometimes when we're going through a circumstance, see, Paul was going through this circumstance. He didn't understand why it was happening. Remember when he was on the shipwreck, when he was being arrested, when he was being sent to, he didn't know any of what was going to happen. But he reached a place in his life where the Holy Spirit, and maybe even some people, maybe you have somebody in your life that be able to help you take the circumstance that you're going through, and maybe they will even be able to say, well, when I look at this, did you see this? And maybe there's a message this morning that God would have for you that would say, you know, I know you see it this way, but have you seen this? This is what's in there that you don't see. And when you look at it hard enough and you look at it close enough and somebody begins to show you, when God begins to define it for you, suddenly you see what you didn't see before and your perspective is changed on the circumstance that you're walking through. Could I tell you that's happened for me so many times I can't count it? See, verse 13. Says this, as a result of what? All the things that he's gone through, he said, as a result, it has become clear throughout the whole palace guard and to everyone else that I am in chains for Christ. As a result of the what that he's going through, suddenly Paul begins to see the why. Now, folks, I'm not always saying that you're going to see it quickly. In fact, it may be that you may never see it till the day you go to be with the Lord and it all becomes clear. There's some things in my life that there's nothing that's ever happened, even the worst of things that's happened in my life, that with time, I didn't begin to see some of God's why and what he used that for to bring out in me to change my life. And Paul says, listen, all of this has happened so that the gospel can be proclaimed to the whole Roman palace. The Praetorian Guard. He's saying some of the most influential people in Rome are chained to him 6 hours a day in rotations. And so you might begin to ask, oh, well, who is the prisoner here? Because I would say to you that anybody chained to a preacher, you know what I'm saying? Anybody chained to a preacher would be saying, no, I'm the one in prison. These guys were chained to the Apostle Paul. And I'm sure they had plenty of time to talk. And Paul was declaring to them the gospel of Jesus Christ. And from that cell, the message of the gospel was being proclaimed throughout the Roman palace. He says in verse 14, because of my chains, most of the brothers in the Lord have been encouraged to speak the word of God more courageously and fearlessly. He said, not only is the palace guard getting the message, but he said, even the people in Rome, the Christian brothers and sisters in Rome are being emboldened and encouraged, and they're beginning to speak more passionately the word of God. So it's not only affecting the Roman guards, but it's affecting the church. Paul's saying the gospel is being advanced because I have been in prison. It's amazing. It's amazing. Second question. The first question is, now what? What does God want to do? Okay, it's happening. Now what? What do you want to do in me, through me, in this situation, God? What is it that you want to bring to pass? I am at your mercy. I'm here. The second question is, so what? Now what and so what? We're going to ask that question. When we ask so what, it's another way of saying, okay, what's going on here? What's the purpose? Let me read another verse in verse 15. Paul says, it is true that some preach Christ out of envy and rivalry, but others out of goodwill. He said, the latter do so in love, knowing that I am put here for the defense of the gospel. The former preach Christ out of selfish ambition, not sincerely, supposing that they can stir up trouble for me while I am in chains. Okay, so get the picture. Paul says, I'm in prison. I can't get out. I can't take care of business out there. He said, there's some people that are out there preaching the gospel. I don't even know how that worked exactly, but apparently there was wrong motives. They were preaching the gospel somehow to set up a rivalry with the Apostle Paul and gain influence or whatever it was, but their hearts were not right in what they were doing. That's the situation. Paul said, then there are others that are preaching the gospel out of sincere heart. But listen to what he says now. He says, but what does it matter? But what does it matter? The important thing is that in every way, whether from false motives or true, Christ is preached, and because of this, I what? I rejoice. There it is again. See, even this terrible situation, guys are trying to stir up trouble for him, trying to make him feel bad, trying to make him feel less than. But Paul says, it doesn't matter. What does it matter? He said, I'm going to rejoice even in this. Focus on that phrase, what does it matter? In the Greek, that phrase is tisgarplein. Tisgarplein. You pronounce that P-L-E-N, plein, kind of like tattoo. How many of you remember tattoo? The plein, okay? How many of you know what I'm talking about? Raise your hand. Oh, this is so funny. I said this in the first service. Everybody raised their hands. In this service, everybody's going, what are you talking about? Have you lost your mind? There was just a shout out, thanks for the love from those of you that watch Fantasy Island. Tattoo was a guy on Fantasy Island, and when the planes would come in, they always began every show with him pointing, going, the plane. And that's how you say it, by the way. Tisgarplein. Okay, you don't have to say it like Tattoo, but that's how it's said. And it means, what does it matter? See, that's one of the questions we need to ask when we're walking through a situation. I'm not saying that it doesn't matter, but I'm saying that we need to ask the question, what does it matter? Because in one hand, Paul says, does it matter that he's been put in chains and he's been taken to a Roman prison? He says, yes, it matters a lot because it's served to advance the gospel. But does it matter that these people are talking bad about him and preaching the gospel with false motives? He's saying, what does it matter? The implication is it doesn't matter at all, does it? He's saying, listen, the real point is the gospel's being proclaimed. Did you know that there are people, I've heard some really wacko people preaching the gospel. And in the first service, I got an amen on that as they looked at me. Okay? But there are some that today that preach the gospel with false motives. Would you agree with that? Yeah, we've seen them, haven't we? People that preach the gospel with wrong motives, to enrich themselves or to gain some kind of fame or notoriety or whatever it is. You know, I even remember seeing a movie about a guy that was an evangelist, did tent evangelism and all that, and Rome went around, and he was famous. But he never believed one word of what he was preaching. It was all a show. And he later became a B-rated movie star. But it was all a show. And then when it became known what he was doing, because he made this movie that ridiculed the people that he was actually preaching to, when it became known, people were going, oh my gosh, all these people that believed his message and gave their life to Christ, now it's all a sham. No. He's a sham. The gospel is true. He's lost. They're saved. You see, it doesn't matter. That was a relief to me as a young pastor. I said, hey, what does it matter? These people got saved. God will deal with him. And so we're in this place. Paul is saying, this is what has happened. It really doesn't matter. So what? Here's a question I would maybe help you to ask. And whatever's happening, you ask the question, will this matter 100 years from now? Or even 5 years or 10 years from now? Will it really matter? The guy that cut you off in traffic, what does it matter? Really, what does it matter? I saw a guy, we were at a drive-thru eating a fast food going up to see my granddaughter's graduation. And Don and I can no longer go out to a nice restaurant when we travel to eat because we have a dog, Millie. Okay, I was against getting a dog, but we got a dog. Now, Cora, I love her. We go in the drive-thru. Now we become those people. You know who I'm talking about? The people that not only order food for themselves but get their dog chicken nuggets. Okay, that's us. So we're going through this drive-thru, and this guy pulls in two cars ahead of us with a big old truck and a trailer on it, and he's going to go through the drive-thru. And I don't know why the guy in front of me got so upset about it, but he got out of his car and he walked up there to this truck's window and tap, tap, tap on the window, and the window comes down. You can hear them shouting at each other. And I'm thinking, you know, what does it matter? This car playing. Who cares? I mean, who cares if this guy's going through the drive-thru with his truck and his trailer? Apparently it bothered this guy. But we need to ask the question, so what? Because so much of what we get upset about, so much what we focus on really doesn't matter. Paul right here is telling us, listen, let's read on. Let's read it again. He said, what does it matter? The important thing is, you see what he's saying? Don't get distracted by things that aren't important. Get focused on what is important. The important thing is that the gospel is being shared. The important thing is that the gospel is being shared, whether it's from false motives or true. If we could just learn to ask the question, now what? What is it, God? We move past the why. We get focused on the now what? What do you want me to do? What do you want me to be? How do you want me to do this? What do you want to bring out of this? And then we ask about some things, the so what? What does it really matter? What difference is it going to make in my spiritual life? What difference is it going to make in my family's life? In fact, how I handle this, how I ask to answer this question, the so what, can in large measure determine whether you not actually reach the important thing. In other words, the important thing is not that I get this guy told off because he cut me off in traffic or he shouldn't be going through the drive-thru with his truck and his trailer. The important thing is that my kids see me handle things in a patient and responsible manner, in a loving manner. That they see me be able to say, so what? It doesn't matter. What does it matter? Yeah, the important thing is that God can, through that, work in me to produce a character that he wants to produce. Not that I just continue to be the same old person I always was. And that's why some of the difficult things that we walk through, I mean, don't we understand? You ought to all agree that the greatest growth you've experienced in your life was not through the, you know, great vacations you took to the Bahamas. The great thing that happened in your life was the difficult thing you went through and what God produced out of that. And I'm here to testify. I want you to know that the test that you go through today will be the testimony you have tomorrow. Okay? And I'm here to tell you, I mean this. Don and I have walked through some really difficult, hard things in our lives. But I am here to tell you that every single thing we've gone through, it's been hard. There have been some negative things that happened. But what I'm telling you is that somewhere down the line, God always shows us that different perspective. There is always a why behind the what. And it may be that the why is just what he is doing in you through the circumstance. What does it matter? What's really important? Paul concludes in verse 21. He says, for me, I can't speak for you, Paul says, but for me, to live is Christ and to die is gain. Talk about perspective. Talk about perspective. If I live, I'm going to live to serve him. If I die, I get to go to heaven and be with him. What does it matter? He said, if I'm to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me, yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to part to be with Christ, which is better by far, but it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. He says, it doesn't matter. It's in God's hands. The what always has God's why behind it. And when we can learn to trust God in the what without having to know the why. That's called faith. That's called trust. Let me ask you something. Do you know Jesus Christ as your Savior? Because whatever the circumstance you find yourselves in, whether it's today or tomorrow, whatever the circumstance you find yourselves in, if you're a child of God, that means you have a relationship with your Creator through Jesus Christ. If you're a child of God, He will always bring a great why out of whatever it is that's happening. And it doesn't mean that the what is going to be any less difficult in some circumstances. You hear what I'm saying? But what I am saying is that God will always produce something meaningful and something valuable out of whatever it is that you go through in your life. Heavenly Father, we thank you this morning for your love and your goodness. Lord, we thank you for the promise of eternal life that you give to us. And Lord, we thank you that while we're walking through this life on this journey, Lord, that whatever it is we walk through, as Paul said, what has happened has served to advance your purpose. Lord, I pray today, if there are those that don't know you as Savior and Lord, that they would say yes to you now. Father, if there are those here today that maybe they're already believers, have been, and just have drifted away, just have gotten out of touch, have lost contact with you, Lord. They recognize in their heart right now that the most important thing that we could possibly do is walk in that relationship, not to waste it. So, Lord, I pray for each and every person that's here today that you would bring about your perfect will in their lives. And we pray this in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Would you stand with me as we sing this song of invitation today? Just want you to know that I'm here to pray with you. If you have a need in your life, I'll pray with you. If you want to trust Christ as your Savior, I would rejoice in being able to pray with you this morning. You just want to come back and begin serving again, putting down fresh roots, I would love to pray with you about that. So as we continue right now, you do whatever it is that God is calling you to do.
And my Jesus, I love thee. My Jesus.
You know, it may be that right now things are fairly smooth in your life. We've all been through things like we talked about this morning. But right now, maybe you know somebody else. Sometimes it's good to remember that when we pray for others, it has a way of affecting our own situation, how we feel. So I'm going to ask you right now, a moment of silence. I'm just going to ask you to bow your heads, and I want you to lift up a prayer for someone that you know right now, that you know is walking through a difficult time. I want you to lift them up silently, quietly in your heart right now. Sing one more verse and we'll close.
My Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign.
Seated for just a moment. You guys, I want you to come on up here. The Haltons, I want to ask them to come up, and I want to pray. We're going to pray for Lily this morning. She is going to be serving this summer at Camp Zephyr, the same camp that our children and our youth will be going to. So she's going to be serving there as a counselor and a worker there at Camp Zephyr. And, you know, I consider this a mission journey. This is a missionary trip. She'll have an opportunity to affect and impact the lives of children and other teenagers. And I just want to lift her up in Lord through prayer this morning and just ask her family to join with us in this prayer. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for young people that you have called out, you've anointed and given a purpose and a calling to a work. Lord, we pray for Lily as she goes to Camp Zephyr this summer, Lord, that she might be able to impact young people's lives. Lord, we know how important it is in the lives of our elementary age kids to see other young people that are committed and dedicated and have a testimony for you. Lord, it's also important for our teenagers that they see that quality. So Lord, I lift up Lily to you. Pray that you'd use her to advance your kingdom and your gospel in the lives of young people this summer. And we pray her family as she's gone away from them. And we lift all of this up to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. 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 God bless you, Lily. You betcha. Thank y'all. We're going to ask you to stand. All right, if you'll stand, just want to remind you, if you're visiting with us this morning, after we've said our closing prayer, in their bulletin, you'll see a little card on the side that says a connection card. If you're visiting especially, we would really love to have a record of your presence here today. If you would just fill that out on the side, leave it on the chair after you leave, and we'll pick them up after the service is over. Also, for everybody, whether you're visiting or not, on the back side of that form, there is a place for your prayer request. And we do lift up every request that we receive from you. And so it's very important from our members and from anyone visiting that you share those with us. We'll be sure that we pray for you, okay? Let's go to the Lord in prayer right now and let's be dismissed. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the word that you've given us this morning. Lord, we thank you for the Apostle Paul and his example that he sets of how to change our perspective and how that perspective change can change how we respond and who we are. Lord, I pray as we go today that you would help us live into that ourselves. And Lord, I thank you for each person here today. Lord, I pray for your richest blessing upon their lives. I pray that they might leave here today with the joy of the Lord on their hearts and minds. Lord, that we could go out of here today being the people that you want us to be. This prayer we lift up to you in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you. Thank you.